about that. You missed all the funny quips, you know? Yes. Error with what? Okay, so should I should. Ah, yes, okay, good. Okay, so does anybody accept maybe this one is slightly questionable. This one might be questionable. This is very convincing. But for people who didn't already know the answer, does anybody see a pattern? Just among people who haven't seen this before? Anybody? Yes. Yes, edges is one less than the sum of the, let me rewrite what you just said. Vertices minus edges plus faces. Here it's 1, 1, 1, experimental error. Experimental error, 1. Okay, you should recount those. And if you get something else, then we'd have even better mathematics than I thought here. But the theorem, the amazing pattern discovered by Euler in the 1750s is that no matter how you triangulate a polygonal region, a disk, V minus E plus F always equals the same number. Even though each individual term on the left-hand side is varying dramatically with the person, the right-hand side is typically not. Varying. And so let me just give, there are many proofs of this theorem, but let me just give a single proof. Here's a proof you can induct. There are many, many ways to prove this, and I suggest that you try to find your own. Induct on F. F is the number of faces. Induct on F. F equals 1. If there's one face, that means you have one triangle. I'm calling it a face. I know it's not a face of anything, but it's just, this is standard terminology, right? So, so here it's true. V is 3, E is 3, F is 1. So V minus E plus F is indeed 1. And now, the inductive step can you see this back there? So the inductive step is, what you want to do is you want to remove, I guess you can add or remove, one triangle at a time. Let's think of it as removing one triangle at a time, and I'm not going to ever remove interior triangles. I will always remove a triangle that has one edge exposed to the outside. And so there's two cases. One case, you have some region, I don't know what it looks like, you know, chock full of triangles. You know, I don't know what it looks like, etc. And basically, you're removing a single triangle. Okay, I guess there's only one color here. But you're moving a triangle T. Let's call the triangulation here T. And this triangulation with this triangle T, what do I want to call this? Here, let's just call this triangle T. So removing T, what does it do to the, so I remove this triangle with the dotted lines, what does it do to vertices? Minus 1. So V goes to V minus 1. What does it do to edges? Yes, E minus 2. And what does it do to faces? It subtracts 1. And then, so this means when you take V minus E plus F, remains unchanged. So this plus this means you're subtracting 2, and then minus this means you're adding 2 to V minus E plus F. So it remains unchanged. And case two, this was case one. Case two is where you're removing a triangle. You know, I don't know what the rest of it's like, but you're removing a triangle T that has two edges, that only has one exterior edge. This triangle had two edges that don't share an edge with another triangle. This only has one exterior edge. And here you can see the number of vertices, what happens to it? Stays the same. I didn't remove a vertex. I'm just removing this triangle completely. And so the number of edges goes down by one because I removed this one edge. And the number of triangles, the number of faces, goes down by one. And so V minus C plus F remains unchanged. And so that's the proof. Okay, any questions? So this one's pretty easy to prove. And there's a better theorem. So let me just do firstly, let sigma G be the genus G greater than or equal to 0 surface. And for people who know the words, I mean closed, connected, oriented. But if you don't know those words, it's just the thing that is homeomorphic to, so sigma 0 is the 2 sphere. G refers to the number of handles. So this has no handles. This is supposed to have one handle, which is the circle across the circle, which is sometimes known as the torus. Sigma 2 is the donut with two holes. I don't want to spend time going through the basic theory of surfaces, but I think people have seen this kind of thing before, etc. Okay? It's sometimes called genus G because you're adding handles, because up to continuous deformation, for example, this is just a sphere with two handles added, like a hobby horse, but with two handles. Okay? And the real theorem of Euler is that for any decomposition, sometimes called a triangulation, of the genus G surface into triangles, you always have V minus E plus F is 2 minus 2G. So when G is 0, that number is 2. When G is 1, the number is 0. When genus is 2, the number is minus 2. And then it goes minus 4, minus 6, etc. Okay. The theorem is, see, the left-hand side depends, V, E, and F depend dramatically on the choices you make. The right-hand side doesn't. The right-hand side is just a constant, depending only on which surface you're on. So proof, I'd like to give this as an exercise that you can think about tonight. It's very easy to do it on the two-sphere, because the two-sphere consists of like two disks glued together. If you take out one triangle, the complement is a disk. So that's really easy. But then for the torus and higher genus surfaces, it's not so obvious, is it? It's not even obvious how you'd start drawing a triangulation. You have to really get into representations somehow of surfaces. So questions? So that's a really remarkable theorem. And it's the first theorem that's going to illustrate what I'd like to illustrate today, mostly in dimension 2, is that this is one of the first theorems, the starting point of algebraic topology. And one of the key themes I'm going to illustrate today is local information determining global information and global determining local, this kind of interplay between local and global. What's local here? What's local is sort of choosing a kind of triangulation of my surface. What's global here is some number depending only on like which surface it is. Amazing generalization, which is one of the cornerstones of all of algebraic topology, and this was known to Poincaré, is that for any space, let me just say it officially, it's called simplicial complex. Actually, yeah, it's much more general, but simplicial complex decomposed and I don't want to get into the exact definitions. It's not what I'm interested in doing right now, but decomposed into zero simplices, which are otherwise known as vertices, one simplices, that's edges, triangles, tetrahedra, those are three-dimensional simplices, and then there's four-dimensional simplices. If you let Ci and you define it to be the number of I simplices, you can, of course, in this fixed space, make these numbers, not anything you want, but they can vary dramatically. Then, so for any space X, the sum of minus one, the alternating sum of these numbers, from I equals 1 to however much you need to do, that's a constant depending only on X. And when I say on X, I mean on the topology of X, on the homeomorphism type. And by homeomorphism type, a homeomorphism between two, I mean either you know it or you don't, but two spaces are, if you can do a continuous deformation from one to another, if there's a continuous map whose inverse is continuous between both spaces, and topology studies spaces up to homeomorphism. So this is a pretty amazingly general theorem, and these numbers change, and all of algebraic topology is essentially a kind of refinement of this theorem. The main objects of algebraic topology are homology groups, so if you're interested in this, there's an amazing refinement, and it's right, and this is what homology groups are about, homology theory and cohomology, the theory of cohomology. It attaches numbers to each dimension, like dimension 0, 1, 2, that those numbers don't depend on the topology. So it's not the number of things in a triangulation. It's sort of some kind of number of zero-dimensional holes, one-dimensional holes, two-dimensional holes, whatever the heck that means, these homology groups. But it makes those numbers invariant. And so, of course, their alternating sum is invariant. But this kind of thing, I've been working the last few years. I'm talking today about geometry topology, but I've been working on applications of topology and interactions with representation theory and algebraic geometry and number theory. And I'll just mention one kind of thing. But all the stuff I'm talking about actually can tell us about those subjects and vice versa. So one sample application of just where Euler characteristic comes up elsewhere in mathematics is the following. And before I forget, I should say my title, it's topological invariance. That means invariance under homeomorphism. That means something that just depends on the space, like a disk or a torus, of non-topological invariants. These are non-topological things, right? The number of vertices, edges, and faces. They're not topological. And they can change dramatically, but this alternating sum doesn't. So that's my title. That's the connection to the title. Anyway, here's an example, just a random kind of application, kind of way. This is called Euler characteristic. This is defined to be, it's called the Euler characteristic. It occurs in, basically, I don't know an area of mathematics where it doesn't occur. Maybe that's a comment on the areas of math that I know, but but I know all of math, and so, no. It ran the kind of way that the Euler characteristic occurs outside topology. And this is a really amazing thing. So this is sort of the tip. In fact, Euler characteristic itself is the tip of just an absolutely enormous iceberg. It's a starting point for algebraic topology. But here's a way that has to do with things that I've been thinking about recently, which is the cohomology of arithmetic groups. But here's a sample kind of thing. We've seen a lot of zeta functions in the different talks this afternoon. And maybe I won't define zeta function, but if you take like K as a number field, there are zeta functions for number fields. So maybe I won't even say what it is, because it's not even important. But you want to look at a value of the zeta function, say at minus 1, you want to know if it's like an integer or a rational number. So, okay, they're usually not integers, but suppose I wanted to prove it's rational with denominator 18. So you show that this is an integer. I made up 18, you know, have some fixed example here. But how would you show that some number is an integer? Now, number theorists struggle and struggle and struggle, but one of the great developments in the last 50 years in math has been this huge importation of topology and algebraic topology into number theory. And one good way to show something is an integer, and this is really used for things like this, exactly like this, is to show, is you find a space, X, it's actually a manifold that's also an algebraic variety that also comes from Lie groups and arithmetic subgroups. So that's like I just mentioned three distinct areas of math. And find a space X such that this number, you guys need new chalk, 18 times zeta of X is the Euler characteristic of X. But the Euler characteristic, it's like V minus E plus F minus three-dimensional things plus four. So obviously that's like an integer. That's a good way to prove something's an integer, right? So of course, if you can do this, you've just uncovered some unbelievable secrets, because guess what? There's Euler characteristic is just a number you attach to a space. Algebraic topology since Poincaré, we have lots of other numbers, the Beatty numbers, the homology and cohomology groups. And in fact, they're not just numbers, they're groups or vector spaces and sometimes representation. And it goes on and on and on and on. So once you see this, you can never look at the zeta function again unless you're studying, you know, you hear the words Chamorro variety, you hear all these words, unless you're studying, like how could you not look at that? You're just looking at like, the zeta function is just some tiny little shadow of this much grander thing, and you're just looking at like some random number attached to it. So this is pretty amazing to me. I don't have the time to sort of go more into why this is true. Okay, let me move on to number two. So that was amazing theorem number one. Yeah, this is also a test. Basically, if you want to know if you'd be interested in geometry or topology, if you don't like any of these theorems, it's like the math test. If you don't like Cantor's proof that there's the reals are uncountable, you know, the rest of math, it doesn't get that much better. I mean, math is amazing. It gets much deeper, right? But like, do you know anybody? If you're not like completely blown away, then you definitely shouldn't do math. I'd be that definitive about that. And if you're not sort of blown away by these things, then like geometry topology is probably not for you. Because I mean, if you compare this to like other topology work, like Davis's work, come on. No, sorry. He actually is a world expert on this kind of stuff. Okay, so number two, great theorem number two, I'd like to talk about the Poincaré-Hopf index theorem. So what is this theorem about? This theorem is one of the basic theorems of differential topology. And I'm going to do it in the case of a surface, although what I say is really super general with almost no changes to arbitrary manifolds. But suppose I have a genus G surface embedded in three space. There you go, genus zero surface here. And let me give a definition. A smooth vector field, probably you've seen this in multivariable calculus, on sigma g. I'm going to just write sigma g, but I'm thinking of it maybe as embedded in R3, although there's an intrinsic way to do all this. You don't really need it embedded, but on sigma g is a smoothly varying choice, I'll say V sub x, lying in the tangent space to sigma g at the point x. That's it. So it's a smoothly varying choice. So for example, let me do it first on a sphere. If this is the unit sphere, sigma 0, which is S2, which is the set of x, y, z, such that x squared plus y squared plus z squared is 1, So given a point, x naught, y naught, z naught, I need to give you a vector. And I need to make sure it's in the tangent, it's tangent to the sphere at that point, which is exactly that you're perpendicular to x naught, y naught, z naught. So let's get a vector that dot products with this guy to 0. How about minus y naught, whoops, I don't know why I put vectors on this, minus y naught, x naught, 0. Okay? So this vector field, what does it look like? Let's see it. 0, 0, 1, you get the 0 vector. I never said it had to always be positive. Couldn't be the 0 vector. Do you see it? At 0, 0, 1, you get 0, 0, 0. Same here at minus 1. But at like x is 1 and y is 0, so let's see. I think you get something like this. It's sort of one of these things. It's like wind blowing. It's like the vector field for wind blowing around the Earth. Right? And so around each of the poles, it looks something like this. It's spiraling around. And this is the way that you can see that you sort of need a 0 there. And let me just do it in R2. Let me just give a few examples. You have v of xy just in R2. I could take v of xy as the constant vector field, which is just at every point. Moving up. I could have, you know, v of xy equals minus yx, which is like this one. So let me do something more interesting. How about v of xy is xy? So this is the vector field that at a point xy, it's just, that's the size of the vector. So at 0, it's 0. It has a single 0 at 0 comma 0. And as you move out, the vectors get bigger and bigger, right? So it's like a source. And I could put minus xy. You know, minus x, minus y. And it's the same thing, except all the vectors are pointing in. Right? And they're getting bigger and bigger as you go out. Let me just do one more that's sort of interesting. One, let's do v of xy. So again, I'm just writing down a bunch of vector fields in the plane that are obviously smooth. Whatever smoothly varying means, this should be it. That like the coordinates are smooth functions. And it's like, let me just do minus x, comma y. Now this one's an interesting one, because you're pointing in on the x-axis. You have vectors pointing in on the x-axis. And on the y-axis, the vectors at points are pointing out. And somehow between them, you're sort of interpolating. So usually you draw this picture to just indicate like what the... Can people see that? Or is that too small? I think it's probably too small. Let me not do bad board work here. Minus x comma y. Right, when x is 1, you get minus 1 comma 0. And when x is minus 1, you get 1 comma 0. And then here you get, here you're pointing away. And then the intermediate ones. Okay. So notice each of these has sort of a single, what's called isolated 0. The vector is the 0 vector, but only at one point. Okay, so here's a question for you. Which surfaces, sigma g, so the sphere, the torus, the genus 2, the genus 3, admit a non-vanishing, and by non-vanishing I mean never the zero vector field. Like the sphere that had two zeros. I mean, there's another famous vector field on the sphere, namely the magnetic force on the Earth. Everything points towards the North Pole, which these days is not at the North Pole, but we'll forget that. We're mathematicians, right? That has two zeros as well. But can you do a non-vanishing vector field on a sphere? Sometimes it's called the hairy ball theorem that you can't. Any smoothly varying vector field on a two sphere has to have a zero. But how about on a genus, on a torus? Well, how about on a torus? Yes? Yes. On a torus, you could. I am going to cheat a little, because you can really see it here. You can identify this, glue this with this. I think people have seen this, and this side with this side, and that gives you the torus. And here you can really write down the vector field. You can do it here too, literally in coordinates with sine and cosine, right? Because the circle has a non-vanishing vector field, right? It's x comma y. At the point x comma y, it's minus y comma x. And that's never zero on the unit circle. And you could do that, cross it, sort of rotate it around. But here you could even do just like the constant vector field pointing up. So, and the theorem, which is a special case of Poincaré-Hopf index theorem, says sigma g admits a nowhere zero, just to emphasize nowhere, nowhere zero smooth vector field if and only if g is 1, i.e., sigma g is the torus. See, it's not so obvious. Go ahead. Can you do it or not on genus 2? Like, why not? Like, you can't check every possible way of doing it. But this is local versus global again, right? Because the information you're giving, I'm giving you genus 2 surface. That's global. This is the picture of the whole thing. But I'm now asking you to specify. You might say, well, look, just start doing a vector field pointing this way. That's fine. Just point to the right. Ready? Here's the picture. Here's an embedding. I'm just going to take this vector field, pointing to the right, pointing to the right. Okay, I start to go under. It's pointing. Now it's pointing to the left. Like, can it match up or not? That is so hard to tell. And modern topology gives you ways of telling. And this is one of the things. I'll talk about the general theorem. The general Poincaré-Hopf theorem tells you any vector field on the two-sphere has to essentially like look like this. It gives a formula. And we'll see what that formula has to do with. But I want to give Thurston's proof of this. So this is something that I'll be interested. Actually, I was talking to Mike earlier, who I'm curious if he's seen this. Because usually when I give like talks to undergrads and I ever talk about this thing, I give something that most senior people, even in topology, haven't seen this proof. Because this is due to Thurston. It's a totally amazing proof. And the proof I'm about to give you, I would say, is a chunk towards the direction of some of the greatest topology theorems of all time due to Thurston, like the classification of codimension 1 foliations, for which you won the Fields Medal. But it goes all the way down to this proof. It's much more than this, but this gives the first little taste. So proof of this theorem. One direction's easier. I mean, obviously, we already did one direction. So proof that if you have been in a non-vanishing vector field, then your Euler characteristic is zero. So you're the torus. So proof that sigma admits, and this actually works in all dimensions, a non-vanishing, a nowhere vanishing, smooth vector field implies the Euler characteristic of sigma is zero. That's the real theorem. And this is due to Thurston. It's totally awesome. Okay, are you ready? What do we do? Well, so we have this vector field. V. Okay. It's smooth. It's smoothly varying. So by continuity, just by continuity, it's locally almost constant, locally almost constant direction. What I mean by that is, if you sort of measure locally a kind of how it's changing, I can make it change as little as I want, right? From the constant, I can make it look almost like a constant vector field. That's just what continuity means. So they're all sort of pointing in the same direction on an incredibly tiny, tiny, tiny scale. Well, let's blow it up a little bit. So now what I want to do is triangulate, cut it into triangles, triangulate sigma with triangles so small that on each triangle, T, the vector field is close to constant, close to the constant vector field. So I just make these incredibly tiny triangles here. So here's an example. Let's focus in on a triangle. Your vector field, let's say it looks like it's sort of, let's say going to the right and up just a little bit. Okay? Another option would be it's going, like, say, directly up. Okay, any questions? Like, it's completely going up everywhere, including inside the triangle. But I want to leave the inside on top, you know. Any questions? Do you sort of believe me that you can do this if I make the triangle small enough? And let me jiggle it, do a little bit more that, again, mathematically, everything I'm saying can absolutely be proved. But obviously, I don't want to get technical, too technical here with this limited time. But give me the geometric idea. You can do it so that it's not pointing in the constant direction, is not in any of the three directions of the edges. Okay. So once you do this, here's the beautiful thing. Ready? I'm going to compute the order characteristic of the surface. I'm going to use the fact that it's never zero anywhere to compute order characteristic. Think of order characteristic as a charge. When each vertex, remember, it's V minus E plus F. I'm going to compute this. Compute it. I'm going to put a plus charge on each vertex. On each edge, right in the middle, I'm going to put a minus charge, an electron. And then right in the center, I'm going to put a positive charge. Do this on every triangle. So let's pretend the room is the whole surface, and everyone in this room has their individual triangle that they're monitoring. And we put the charge down. Of course, it's a surface. There's no boundary. And so secretly, there's like another triangle here that you're monitoring. And the vector field's locally constant, maybe in some different direction relative to that triangle, but that's fine. So any questions? So here's what I want you to do. So the total charge, the order characteristic of the surface, is the total charge. And of course, I have no idea how much that is right now, right? I haven't done anything. I haven't used anything. But you agree it's the total charge. It's V minus E plus F. So ready? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to use the vector field to flow for a trillionth of a trillionth of a trillionth of a second. For an incredibly tiny distance, the distance like a trillionth of the length of the diameter of the triangle. Ready? Go. All the charge starts moving. This charge stays in the center, yeah? It moves a little bit. The charge at this vertex here, let me do this picture. There's two other pictures to do, but this positive charge moves into the center. This negative charge moves into the center. This positive charge, this is a local picture, right? It's a local picture. When I cut these triangles really small, it's local. It's like a little copy of R2. That's what a surface is. It's locally, around each point, there's a neighborhood that looks like the plane. And so I can completely monitor and know what's happening. This literally is the picture. This charge moves outside. Do you agree this negative charge moves off and this moves off? So the total charge in this triangle after the flow, the charge in this triangle, this one triangle in my triangle, what is it? It's these all move outside. It's this one, and this one count. It's two negative and two positive, so it's zero. Here, do you guys see this? That moves outside, this moves outside, this moves outside, this moves outside, this moves outside. The only one that moves in is this negative charge, and the positive charge on the face stays inside, so the total charge here is zero. Now ready? You're doing the same calculation as me. Now it's true, my charge, minus charge, left my triangle. I agree. But somebody in this room must be accounting for it because somebody has a triangle where that charge must have moved in. And so ready? The total charge afterwards is zero. But that was the order characteristic. Because it's zero on each triangle. So So the total charge is 0 plus 0 plus 0 plus 0. We all count. I announce my triangle has no charge. Does anybody have charge? Nope. Okay, it's 0 in the whole thing. It must have been 0 in the whole thing. And this proof fails because if you have a 0 at a vector field, because maybe that 0 was at one of the charges and it doesn't tell you where to go. So we definitely use non-vanishing vector field to flow. So this is sort of an amazing, have you seen it? Totally freaking amazing? Honestly, good? Good? This far surpasses the life's work of Mike David. No. And of Benson Farb. No, this is awesome. Anyway, that's the proof. It's sort of a miracle. And it shows like local to global like happening right there. Now, maybe without going much more into it, let me just give you the general theorem. By the way, literally this proof works verbatim from what I said for all closed manifolds. All manifolds, for people who know those words, all closed manifolds, as long as you don't have boundary. Any n dimensions, you just do the same thing. And it obviously just like works verbatim. And for super duper experts, if you want to, you can always jiggle the vector field a little bit so it's transverse to all the faces and stuff. That's an easy transversality. And so you're just done. It just does this for all manifolds. If you have a non-vanishing vector field, then order characteristic is 0. And Thurston proved the other direction, too. You can actually construct vector fields. Yeah. Anyway. Okay. Cool. The real theorem is the following. So what can I say about the sphere? This doesn't do me any good if I want to understand the flow of fluid on a sphere. Who would want to understand the flows on the sphere? I mean, where would that ever arise? So I don't know. I mean, the Earth. So here's the amazing theorem. Every time you have a zero, we're only going to look at vector fields where the zeros are isolated. In other words, there's not a line of zeros. Or here's a good vector field, the zero vector field, smart aleck. Although that one's a very useful one, because when you perturb it. Anyway, okay, you can always make it by jiggling things that the zeros are isolated. To each isolated zero, you can attach a number. That number is the following. You put a little compass needle, and then you move around, always keeping the north part of the compass needle. This is supposed to be like a directed thing. As you move around clockwise, you look at what the compass needle does. So here, it's rotating once counterclockwise. Do you see that? So I'm going to attach the number minus 1. It's called the index at the point 0, 0 of the vector field V. And this vector field, let's see, I put my little pointer, and as I move around clockwise, it rotates clockwise, so that's a plus 1. What's really funny is, at the sink, I take my thing pointing northward, and as I rotate it, you can check it out, it also goes clockwise. So this is also plus 1. So this is a number, a local measurement at each zero of the vector field. And the real theorem, the Poincaré-Hopf index theorem, and another board. Theorem, the Poincaré-Hopf index theorem, a cornerstone of differential topology, is that if you add up for all smooth vector fields on sigma g, or on any manifold, but on sigma g, vector fields v with isolated zeros, just means there's only one zero. Each zero is just its own little isolated, it's the only zero in the little neighborhood around the point. With isolated zeros, if you add up over the set of points P where the vector field at that point is the zero vector, so you add up over those singularities, the index of that point, this little number we attach just to tell which way you're rotating, index of V at the point P. Notice, by the way, what is this number when you have a non-vanishing vector field? What is the number if it's non-vanishing? 0, it's the empty sum. This is always equal to the Euler characteristic. The right-hand side is topological. This is a whole bunch of numbers that are locally changing. We've seen that before with the V minus E plus F equals 2. I'm giving you hints that these things are like deeply, deeply related. And you can see them all at once as the same theorem. In fact, so I'm not going to explain that to you because I don't have the time, and I have thought about it so much that I can't see why they're different theorems. So. But this is, the right-hand side doesn't depend on anything, it's a constant. This just like will have vast, totally different kinds of vector fields, but it constrains them. And you can prove this. I'd like to give this as a nice homework problem. And you do the same thing that we did before with the V minus C plus F, but for each zero, you have, let's say, two zeros on the sphere. So make those zeros in the center of your triangles. Just do the proof I did that Thurston did. You have nowhere vanishing, everything moves off, all the charge goes to zero, except where you have a singularity. Let's say you have this. Like locally, it looks like this. Then fine, for finitely many triangles, finitely many of us, like you have a singularity, and you have a singularity, your count's going to be different, right? The charge is going like that. And so you get some other number. Guess what? It's like exactly the index. It's like 1 or minus 1, depending on the... So check it out. So you can prove the whole general theorem this way. Okay, so that's the differential topology. Finally, I'm going to end with one great theorem from differential geometry. And again, all three of these sort of use them to prove the others. But any questions on that? Okay. Theorem number 3. The Gauss-Binet theorem. And again, I'd like to be very concrete. There's very general forms, but this is sort of an incredible theorem. And you can use the other theorems that I did just to prove this. Gauss-Binet. And this is also like a starting point for a huge swath of mathematics. The Gauss-Binet theorem is the following. So consider, like, let's just do it for surfaces embedded in R3. Even the sphere, this is an incredible theorem. So if you want, assume G is 0 and you have a sphere in R3. You define the curvature. So let me give a definition sort of via computation. The Gaussian curvature is a smooth function k going from your surface to the reals. It assigns sort of how much you're curving at a given point, given by, and here's, I'm just going to do proof by example, any surface is locally around any point, any p in sigma g, your surface is a graph, of a function, right? You learn this in multivariable calculus. So I want to understand the curvature of something. Here's a round sphere. I want to understand the curvature at a point P. Maybe I want to understand, here's another sphere, a bendy sphere, and I want to understand the curvature at a point P. So without loss of generality, so locally, here's sigma, here's another sigma. Without loss of generality, I can translate the surface. So my surface is the set of things of the form around P. It's a set of things x, y, f of x, y, sigma around P is a set of x, comma y, comma f of x, y, where x is small and y is small. X less than epsilon, y less than epsilon. Right? It's just some little graph of a, here's a little neighborhood on the surface. And I can assume P is the point 0, comma 0, comma 0. In other words, f of x, y is 0. And I can assume by rotating, if you look at the partial f with respect to x at my point P, partial f with respect to y, by rotating, first I can translate so that p is at the origin, and then I can rotate so that the tangent plane is parallel to the xy axis. So that's like saying the partials are both 0. I can always do that. What I'm trying to tell you is, how do you figure out this curvature? And I'm giving you a way to do it explicitly when you give me the surface in space locally as the graph of a function. Okay. Questions? I remember, I have to say, in graduate school, I switched areas and I started to do more geometric things, and so I spent a lot of time with curvature, and my classmates at Princeton were making fun of me because they're like, why aren't you studying a connection on the space of connections on, you know, instanton, da da da? And I'm like literally sitting there writing curves in the plane and dot products. And I spent a lot of time with this. But I'm like, okay, yeah, you're doing like such and such fancy curvature. Like, go ahead, what's the curvature of like on a torus at this point or on the sphere at this point? Go. And at the end, I was the first person to prove the theorems. So it was hard on the ego. Now, I'm saying this because I think for undergrads, the number one mistake I see in grad school is people are so enamored of the machinery that they learn that, but then you can't prove anything. So you're really good in the tea room and you can feel good for a few years. But then at the end of the day, it's like you and a piece of paper and you're like completely alone and all the BS is aside and you better be able to like understand. So I spent like years and years and years on curvature. Basically the secret on fancy things and complex hyperbolic and quaternionic hyperbolic manifolds, basically I understood like surfaces really well. But don't tell anyone, you know, this is the generalization. So anyway, sorry, I couldn't help it. So with the curvature at the point P is the curvature at P, which is the curvature at like 0, 0, we're calling it 0, 0. It's going to be equal to the Hessian of F at 0, 0. Whoops, I haven't taught calc in a long time. Is that, I forget how you, Hessian sub F of 0, 0, whatever the terminology is, it's just partial squared F with respect to x squared at 0, 0, partial squared f with respect to y squared at 0, 0, and then you have the mixed partials. And everything is going to be smooth, so these are equal. Okay? And it's determinant of that. That's a number, yeah? So let me give an example. Great, and I'll finish up with this. Leaving it somewhat mysterious. I hope to just, my goal here is just to like pique your interest with these three things and how they're related, and then you can go explore how exactly they're related. I think I've made some indications. But anyway, so I haven't given the theorem yet. Let me give three examples. So example one is the surface, how about the surface f of xy? I'm just gonna write it as a surface, local. F of xy is zero, or a constant. That's just a plane. And obviously, the curvature is determinant. The partials here, it's the zero matrix. So it's zero. Good, curvature zero, it's flat. K is identically zero at all points. Just good to know. Number two, let me do a sphere, but I have to like translate it. Let me do the south pole. Let me do the unit sphere, or the sphere of radius r. But I have to make it that, you know, this computation is so nice and so clean because I've translated it to here. So this is like f of xy is equal to, what is it? It's r squared, sorry, x squared plus y squared plus z squared is r squared, but that's the z squared, so it's square root minus r, oh, gonna do it, gonna look. I just worked this out this morning. Yes, so it's r plus r squared minus x squared minus y squared square root. Right? It's z minus r quantity squared plus x squared plus y squared is r squared. Okay, this is the sphere of radius r. I'll just do partial f with respect to x, and then they're going to plug in zero. Well, we're not, at 0, 0, you can check. So, but partial f with respect to x, it's 1 half times minus 2x times r squared minus x squared minus y squared to the minus 1 half. Right? So at 0, 0, it's 0, which is very good. So it satisfies my criterion that the first partials are zero. And so now I just have to compute the Hessian. Partial squared f with respect to x squared at 0, 0, what is it? It's the derivative of the first times the second. What's the derivative of the first? So this is minus x times this thing to the minus 1 half. So the derivative of the first is yes, this is r minus. Thank you. Yes, but I think I want it. Oh no, I think I want it plus. I don't. It's not going to matter. And then minus 2x. Da da da. No, this is fine. This is good. This is good. So derivative of the first. Derivative of this is so it's minus 1 times something to the minus 1/2 power. Sorry, times this. But at 0, 0, so it's times r squared to the minus 1/2 power, right? And that's minus 1 over r. And then plus derivative of this, it's going to have a minus 2x in front of it, and so it'll die. So at the end of the day, the Hessian, the curvature at the point 0, 0, it's the second partial. So it's minus 1 over r. Similarly, minus 1 over r. In these, you check are 0. So it's the determinant of this. It's 1 over r squared. And this is intuitively good. This is good. It matches with our intuition that, remember, this is a sphere sitting on a flat plane. And a sphere of radius 1 has curvature 1. But a sphere of radius 100, the curvature at that point, you can see, as r is getting bigger, you can see this is getting flatter and flatter, right? The curvature is going to 0. It's like a measure of how far away you are from flat. Good, so it's 1 over r squared. Finally, the third thing is, let me just say f of xy is x squared minus y squared, which is this monkey saddle. Sorry, I'm just going to draw the picture. This is the picture you should have of negative curvature. Wait, sorry, that's not a good picture. There, this kind of saddle. And that's the point P. And the curvature is the determinant. And it's like 2 minus 2. So it's negative 4. So it's less than 0. Negative curvature is like this. There's a whole big theory. I just wanted to give you some feel. So you have positive curvatures like a sphere, negative curvatures like a saddle, and zero curvatures like the plane. So now, here's my repeated theme. Suppose I, theorem, Gauss-Bonnet theorem. Excellent, right at the end, Gauss-Bonnet theorem. Sorry I went an hour, but. Let sigma g be a surface in R3. You have this curvature function. Now, let's look at two examples. We had the round sphere, where the curvature is constant, minus 1 over. Sorry, it's 1 over r squared. But we also had another metric on the sphere. Here's another embedding of the sphere. You all agree this is a sphere, right? It's just like a deformed sphere. You can see there's points of negative curvature right here, points of positive curvature, and there must be points of zero curvature because it's a continuous function. So you can make the curvature around any point, any sign you want, right? If I wanted it at the South Pole, I can make it negative curvature, positive. I can change it all up. A local measurement. In the local measurement, I can almost make it anything I want. Just like I can make the number of vertices, edges, and faces. Like vertices, I can make it any number I want. Just like in a vector field, I can sort of make a singularity doing whatever I want it to do at one point. Here, I can make curvature whatever I want. But if you integrate that with respect to area on your surface sigma, any surface sigma, I'll call it sigma g. You always get 2 pi, and again, what's controlling everything? Times the order characteristic, which is 2 pi times 2 minus 2g. Reality check, genus 0 is a sphere. You get 4 pi And if you're integrating the sphere of radius r, the area is, so this would be like 1 over r squared, and area is 4 pi r squared. It cancels. Good. That's how I knew I had messed up when I originally did the calculation this morning. Anyway, so here is topology. Here you have this incredibly varying list of numbers that you're essentially adding them all up, of course, integrating. And that's the thing that's constant. It's a fundamental, this incredibly rigid thing. And it's completely controlled. So for example, this implies, for example, that the torus has no metric of positive curvature, right? In fact, it implies so many things. I'll just give one other application. A corollary is that S2 has no Riemannian metric. You can't make it metric with where the curvature is always less than or equal to 0, yeah? Because you can't take a number, a function less than or equal to 0, integrate it, and get 2 or 4 pi. And that's like completely not obvious. So anyway, this is a basic theme in differential geometry. So I hope I gave some kind of little bit of a taste and a teaser for each of these phenomena and the fact that they're all intricately linked. And I will stop.